Easter, everyone. I don't know about you, but my weekend started pretty good. I had duck and turkey. Everyone say duck. I did. Hey, we're part of a comic book series here, too. Come on, guys. You guys need to work with me today. You can't be a dead Easter crowd. Well, I hope you've had a great weekend. I know for some of you that using this superhero kind of comic book characters to really present the Easter story might be a little bit uncomfortable if you haven't saw it done before. Well, guess what? I've never done it before. So this is our first time at taking a crack at it. But let me explain to you a little bit about myself first in understanding. So growing up, one of the things actually which was quite interesting for me is I wasn't good at reading. I wasn't very good at reading, but one day my dad walked along and he dropped this comic book on my bed. I always struggled with reading. I probably could read, but I just had no interest. He's dropped the superhero comic book, Superman, right on my bed, and I began to start reading it. And I started reading more and more to the point that I started buying comic books. I started trading comic books. Now, I wasn't really good with the actual storylines and the alternate universes, but I just enjoyed a good comic book. My life was kind of chaotic, and I really could use a hero to look up to in my life. It was sort of a miracle that I was even able to read. And then one day, you know, my father came up to me, and I remember he took away all my superhero comics because he says I wasn't reading anymore. I was like, what do you mean I wasn't reading anymore? I'm reading comic books. And my dad said, no, you need to start reading your books from school. And, you know, I can tell you that there was a downside to that. I'm almost 49, and I'm watching all of the stories on cartoons and on cinematic film of superheroes. And that's crazy. I might be 49. Well, not quite yet. I got another month to go. But you understand, why at 49 would you? And if you look at all of our communities and our cities and worldwide, people are fascinated with this. But that day that he took him away, I told him that I wasn't addicted to him, and I cried for a couple days. Maybe I was a little addicted. But I want to tell you about another comic book fan. His name was Josh Whedon. And some of you know him. He was the one who directed the first two Avengers cinematic films. He was the one who wrote and directed them. He finished with the Avengers in 2016 and moved over to from Marvel Universe to the DC Universe to finish off a project for them in May 2017. He took over post-production duties for Justice League, which we'll be talking about Batman and Wonder Woman in just a couple weeks, 2 and 3 weeks. He started doing the writing and the directing for the additional photography for the film. But I want to come back now to the Avengers. The first two Avengers movies, maybe they're not now, but they were at the time, the highest gross opening day movies put together. They brought $3 billion to the box office. How would you like to have a little piece of that cake? Everyone, you know, you guys don't? Okay. But I think that that's pretty amazing what the superhero fans, how they came out of the woodwork, and people who weren't fans became fans. Now, what I even think is more amazing than that $3 billion is how much damage in Avengers they did to New York City. Now, they actually said that if you calculate it in real damage, it would come to around $160 billion. $160 billion of damage, which really begs the question with this director. What did he have against New York City? He just wants to demolish this place. But let me tell you, when Josh was 13 years old, he was on his way to a comic book store in New York City. He was jumped by some thugs. He was beaten up and kicked to the ground in broad daylight while hundreds of people walked by and drove by while he continually took a beating right there on the streets. Nobody helped. It's the story of the Good Samaritan without the Good Samaritan. Think of that. He says that he was impacted by the incident. He has not forgotten it. It has tainted his view of both man and also his faith in God for Josh Whedon. And today he is a vowed atheist, and he actually goes to universities and to events to talk about how there is no God. However, with the irony, if you watch his movies, he makes biblical references all through the clips. In just a moment, not yet, but I'm going to let you hear them, but I'm going to tell you in case you miss what they're saying. There's the one part where Vision refers to himself and he says, I am. Then in the first Avengers, one of the best lines, Black Widow refers to Loki and Thor as gods, and she gets corrected by Captain America, and he says, there's only one God, man, and I'm pretty sure he doesn't dress like that. in the age of Ultron, Ultron takes a quote right out of Matthew 16 when he says, upon this rock, I will build my church.
I think I'm a child of Ultron.
You're not?
Thank you.
I'm not Ultron. I'm not Jarvis. I am.
I'd sit this one out, Cap.
I don't see how I can.
These guys come from legend. They're basically gods.
There's only one god, man. And I'm pretty sure he doesn't dress like that.
Upon this rock, I will build my church.
Interesting. His critics said that you're an atheist. Why do you keep bringing all these biblical references into the story in your movies? And you know what he says? He says it's because people need hope. So this atheist brings biblical references because he says people need hope. He says, I have no hope for myself or even for really the human race of all humanity. But people need hope, and really it's a part of a solution, and so I put it into my movies. Interesting that there's always people who say that they don't need faith for themselves, but they think that it's actually good for someone else. So here's what we're going to do with today's Easter message. I'm going to talk about three things. Every story has a villain, has an Avenger, and has the Avenged. We're going to walk through each one of those. And so now, let's start with the villain. There's always a villain in place. And I think the Avengers has this great villain. And you guys have probably seen him. His name is Loki. Now, Loki is the god of mischief. He's cunning. He's crafty. He's a liar. And he's always playing one side against another. Now, I don't know about you, but I think Loki is the perfect replica of Satan himself. When you think that he's cunning, he's crafty, he's always playing the sides, and he is a liar. He's very much someone like that. He tried to usurp his father's powers. He tried to take over the nine realms of the universe. Kind of sounds like Satan, no? In fact, we'll come back and take a look in a moment. But here's a little fun fact, actually, for some of you that don't actually know this. The original character that was cast for Loki, you guys aren't going to believe this one if you don't know, but it was Jim Carrey. So Jim Carrey was originally going to be cast. You guys remember him from Mask? Smoking, somebody stop me. Could you imagine what the Avengers would have looked like? It would have become a comic relief. Thinking about that, though, they would have been so different. But nevertheless, we really have this life story of Loki-type villain in our life. And we're going to talk about it in just a moment. Because here's what happened. Now, by the way, I don't know. I don't read Hebrew really, really well. I have to work at it. I know it says Lucifer. Maybe it's pronounced Lokifer. Who knows? But I want to tell you a little bit about this story here on Earth. Before man was on the scene, God created a race. He created a race of angels. And this race of beings of angels, they had the power to fly. Are you guys following with me? Real life is so close to these superhero stories. They're just a little off. But they had this power to fly. These angels have great strength. When you pray, they come to assist you. And there's this one angel. And he was an archangel named Lucifer, or you could call him today Lokifer. Let me take a look with you in the book of Isaiah, in the 14th chapter in the 13th verse. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet, you should be brought down to Sheol, to the lowest depths of the pit. Okay, so here it is. When you look to the original sin with Lucifer here, we have this created being, Lucifer, who is an angel. He's made by God, who is the God of the universe. He created the heavens and the earth, and he gets in his mind that he will be like the Most High. Lokifer, anyone? Very much the same concept. And if you ever wondered what the original sin was pride. It was pride. Lucifer said, I can take him. And God says, no, you won't. You're going to be brought down to the lowest pits, to Sheol. And now I want to remind you, first, though, that this was written in the book of Isaiah in the future tense, Because on Lucifer's way from heaven to hell, he took a pit stop right here on planet Earth. And so today, he's with us. He's known as the God of this world, the God of our world. You can read about it in Revelations. We don't have time to walk through all those pieces today. I encourage you to go home and read more. When it talks about there was a war in the heavens, it says Michael, the archangel Michael, and his angels fought against Lucifer and his angels, and God cast Lucifer out of heaven down to the earth. He's like, great, like, thanks for giving, making us our problem now. But remember, he was here before us. He came with great wrath, and because Lucifer knows that his time is short. He has a limited amount of time. Now, I know you're probably thinking, why would God send his problem, Satan, and all his angels, which are known as demons, why would he send them from heaven to planet Earth to mess with us? Why would they be coming here? And I'm going to give you one of the reasons I believe why is because of something called free will. It was because of free will. God has given everyone a great, great gift, and that's called free will. He wants us to worship him. He wants us to worship him because we want to, not because we have to. If you have to, you don't have free will. But the problem is you need a legitimate alternative in your free will. A legitimate and opposite alternative to what you already have in your life. It's kind of like, could you imagine being in the communist elections? Is there really a democracy? You know, there's the illusion of a democracy, but it's not a democracy. And so your free will, there had to be two choices. And so on his way, he took a pit stop, and he's here on our planet Earth. God's not going to do that, so he gave us a free will. He's going to give you a credible and opposite alternative all the time. Now, we don't know the exact timing of when Lucifer ended up here on the planet, but we know he's here. When we open our story, we look at Adam and Eve in the garden, and you see Adam and Eve and the serpent. Satan himself is in this garden. He was already here before man came. And God gave Adam one little rule. Just don't eat from this one tree. One tree. You ever do that with your kids? Just don't do this one thing. You know, you can play with all these toys, but please don't play with my phone. And where will that kid go? To the phone. They just go naturally to that place unless you have trained them and worked the discipline to their life through that training. But they go to that place. And this is what the serpent says. He says, God knows you won't die. He knows the day that you eat of this tree, you will be like God, knowing both good and evil. Interesting. What did we say the original sin was? Pride. And of course, here we see it right now again, because pride would want me to actually eat from this tree because I want to be like God. It's just like Lucifer says, I will, 5 times. So Satan knew he got thrown out of heaven, and it was all because he knew his pride would throw him out, and he knew what would happen to Adam and Eve should they follow the same thing. So he tricks them into eating this fruit, into taking this fruit. And the whole world now, when they eat this fruit, is plunged into this predicament of time that we have today, where we are all subjugated to the god of this world, to the devil. And the reason is because of our sins. Our sins subjugate us to the god of this world. And our sins have to have an avenger to help us avenge the sins that we don't have the ability to avenge by ourselves. Our world is teeming with wickedness and evil to the point where you have a 13-year-old boy in New York City being beaten over and over in broad daylight, and nobody does a thing about it. That's wickedness. That's evil. But today it's become unpopular to believe in the devil. Every couple years that passes, the percentages go down. They say that 71% of Canadians believe in a God. But only 37% believe in a devil. Only 37% believe in the devil. If there was no devil, who are you going to blame for all the evil in the world? Who are you going to believe? Interesting enough, insurance companies know who. Because think about when there's a natural disaster, what's it called? It's called an act of God. It's an act of God in a natural disaster. Why isn't it an act of Satan? When has God gone and hurt them? He's not full of evil, but they call it an act of God because they believe in the creation, but not in the destruction of what the devil can do. Nevertheless, we blame God because we don't understand that there is a villain. Now, not everything is Satan. There's things in your life. We've talked in past series and discussions that not everything that happens, sometimes you've got to take responsibility for yourself. But we have to understand that evil comes from one place. And the things and the actions we do come from the influence, how Satan influences our minds today. But there's a villain at loose and he's at play. In fact, I don't know if you heard about the little country church that one day they were worshiping God. The doors burst open and Satan walked into the place. They started running out the doors. They started jumping out the windows. The pastor was first. Everybody was out of there except one old farmer that had a piece of straw. He was picking away at his teeth. And the devil walked up and said, "Why aren't you scared of me?" Or something like that. And he looked and goes, "Because I've been married to your wife for 37 years. There is evil and there is a devil. And we understand the first thing we need to discover in the Easter story is that there was a villain. And because there was a villain, the second thing that we need to learn today, number two, is that there is the Avenger. There is the Avenger. When you have a villain who is Satan, you have an Avenger. And that Avenger comes into your life. Let's take a look now at Isaiah chapter 63, verses 4 to 5. "For the time has come for me to avenge my people, to ransom them from their oppressors. I looked, but there was no one to help, and I wondered that there was no one to uphold. Therefore, my own right arm brought salvation for me." So God looks down. He's not surprised by any of this. And he looks down and he says, "Okay, my time has come to avenge my people from an oppressor. I must avenge." And he's at that point in the place. He says, there is a villain. And he says, but nobody can take out this villain themselves. So I must send an avenger in their place. And so he looks around nowhere because everyone is subjugated to the God of this world by the sin of their life. And God says, okay, let's make a change. The scripture says that all have fallen short of the glory of God because of their sin. That's where we become subjugated to the devil himself. And every one of us has been in that place. And so therefore we need that avenger. And this is why God sent his own right arm, his son, a part of him, Jesus. The why we celebrate Easter, it's because of that. And I love it more when you actually take, let's go back to our superheroes. When you take the Marvel Universe and you take the DC Universe, it doesn't matter, I can put DC here and Marvel here, so in case you're thinking right or left, neither one is right. Everyone has their preferences, but I love it. When you look at Superman, always love Superman. And by the way, we're not talking about Superman this year, but he's invulnerable. He has all these powers. He's smart, he's kind, he's bulletproof, faster than the speeding bullet. He's caring. Some women think he's good looking, but he's got a lot going on. And interesting now, when you think about it, he doesn't really have any weaknesses. Oh, yeah, he's got a little kryptonite. But, I mean, sure, where are you going to find green kryptonite? It's not that much around anymore. And he always finds a way to get away from the green kryptonite when someone comes and helps him somewhere along the way. It's rare. But you move over now to the Marvel Universe, and the Avengers in particular, they're very interesting. Have you ever noticed the human weaknesses in the Avengers? Some of you are like, no, because I've never watched it. But each one of them has this human weakness, and each one of these superheroes are saddled with some serious downsides. So let me walk through. We'll take a look at this picture again so you can see what I'm talking about. We have Iron Man, Tony Stark. I know my grandkids love, they just love Tony Stark. He's a former arms dealer. He's a superhero flying around in this metal suit. He's wealthy, whimsical, witty. You know, you could go on with the W's. But he's a pretty amazing guy, actually. He has one teensy weensy little flaw. Ego. Pride. In fact, what's really interesting, imagine this. He couldn't stand the fact that nobody knew who he was, so he made an announcement to the world. I am Iron Man. Now, what superhero gives up their secret identity? I'll tell you who. A superhero with ego. That's who. In fact, the last New Yorker with an ego that big got elected president, but that's another story. So let's go to the Hulk. This guy's invincible, man. You can't kill this guy. He has a few problems of his own. And I don't know about you, but I can kind of connect with the Hulk. Hulk has this one breathtaking problem. It's his anger management issues. He is the Hulk because of anger. And when he goes through, and I want you to think about this, when he goes through, he actually does more damage than he probably does good. I would say out of those billions of dollars that came down in New York City, he was to blame for half of that, just with his little appearance. But that's what anger does in your life. That's what anger does in my life. You can spend your whole life building a relationship, and then you have an outburst of anger, and you kill the relationship. You just destroy it. Are you like Iron Man? Is there ego, pride? Are you like Hulk? Is it really about the anger issues that are hurting you? But let's take a look at Black Widow. Not many people know about Black Widow as much as those that are fanatical fans. She's wrapped with guilt in her life because she's done some things and she knows she's done some things wrong. She lives with the guilt and the shame of what she's done. Just like a lot of us have done stuff and we live with that guilt and shame. And you know what guilt is? It's the gift that just keeps on giving and giving and giving. Yeah. And then there's Captain America. Now this guy is unique. He's really kind of the best character of the bunch. When I mean character, he has more character than all of them put together. He's sort of a science experiment during the Second World War, and he became this super soldier that got frozen in ice. And he gets woken up 70 years later in modern time, and even though he's a decent human being and he has a whole bunch of really good qualities in his life, he does have a problem. He's irrelevant because he's a man out of season and he just can't seem to relate to this world. Who's like that? Well, that would be many of you. I look at Christians today and they're decent people. They truly are. But just like Captain America, oftentimes Christians don't know how to relate to our world. We're not relevant and we don't understand. And we're trying to connect and keep in touch. But it's kind of like we feel like we're from another age or another planet. But then let's go to Thor. He's the god of thunder. He's the son of Odin. And I'm going to stop there because next week we're going to dedicate an entire message to Thor. So we had four heroes. Now let's do a self-analysis. If I picked one of those four, could you say that one of those four would be you? Could you just raise your hand? One of those four, maybe it's ego, it's pride, it's, okay, we got half of you. So I forgot to give you a superhero that talks about lying. Maybe we'll take a villain. Like you don't have any of those? Okay, well, maybe you might have Thor's and we'll talk about that next week. But we all have stuff. We all have weaknesses in our lives. We're subjugated to that weakness, to that sin in our life. And you're decent people, but you have a sinful nature, and none of us are able to redeem ourselves. And so we all need help. We all need an Avenger. We all need someone in place because we're subjugated to these things in our life where we make these mistakes over and over because of our weaknesses. And there was an Avenger, and his name was Jesus. God sent his own son, his right arm, because there was nobody that could be that Avenger. Let me just illustrate about having a weakness with you. I just want to share a story that happened over 19 years ago. Back in Brandon, Manitoba, when we were out there, I was asked on behalf of our Brandon Ministerial to be part of a very large Christian movement called the Power to Change campaign. It was taking place in our region in the southwestern part of Manitoba, and we were planning some big platforms to really share the good news of Jesus. And interesting enough, over these 2 to 3 weeks, we brought in three different people specifically, and you may know of some and you may not. One was Amanda Stott. She was a singer-songwriter. We brought in Dale Lang. There was the Tabor shootings back in, I believe, 1997. His son was killed by a random shooter that came into the school. He came to speak to the schools on forgiveness. And then, above all that, we had a legendary and an icon hockey hero, Paul Henderson. So all three of these people came in. Now, I got to tell you about Paul Henderson. He's known for leading Team Canada to victory in the 1970s. So if you're millennial, you may not know about this unless you follow hockey. In the 1972 Summit Series, which was against what was known then as the Soviet Union. It was played during the Cold War. Go look it up if you're not sure what that means on Google. But the series of hockey was considered as a battle of both hockey and cultural supremacy. And that's what that series was all about. And Henderson scored the winning goal in the 6th, the 7th, and the 8th games. All three of them, which made him, and especially in that 8th game, which made him that legendary and icon national hero in Canada. Now let me go back to tell you the rest of my story. Because I was in charge of some specific areas, namely my passion for hockey, I asked to be a part of that program, and they requested that I help co-host and MC the event with Paul Henderson. Well, about 15 minutes before the event was about to begin, I'm just hanging. I'm listening to all the stories that Paul Henderson has, and they were gold. They were good hockey stories, incredible stories of things that happened back then. But then I had this thought. As I'm with the iconic Paul Henderson, I had this thought, or at least I do now. I am Iron Man. It's like, I got some ego now. I'm feeling pretty proud that I'm with the hockey legend here. And interesting enough, the local Brandon news station wanted to do an interview. So they called me over to do this short 2-minute interview. You know, the lights go on, the cameras. I'm pretty excited because I am Iron Man. And they come up, and they're right there in Brandon. She says, we are here in Brandon, Manitoba, in front of hundreds and hundreds of people who have joined together. I am standing with a hockey icon, a legendary hockey hero, Paul Henderson. Whoa, 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 whoa. Stop. Kill the lights. I was like, you think I'm Paul Henderson? You think I look like him? I have to tell you, he was born in 1943. I was born in 1970. And I'm thinking to myself, do they know I'm 30? He's 57? All of a sudden, I kind of changed my thought process. And they say, you don't know who he is? And I go, no, I know who he is. He's right over there. The lights go down and they walk away. And then I'm left thinking, he's Iron Man. And he was. He was the man. He was the man of the moment. But it's interesting how the Lord works when your weakness starts coming up. Kind of puts you down a level. Makes you really stop and think and smell the roses. Let's take a look in Matthew 23 and verse 12. It says, whoever exalts himself shall be humbled, and whoever humbles himself shall be raised to honor. When you exalt yourself, you will find you will be humbled. And when you humble yourself, which is what he asks us to do, you will receive the honor. Sometimes in life, we just really need reminded of who we really are. Every one of us has a weakness. We have a frailty here on planet Earth, and we have a sinful nature. It's kind of like where we say, I'm okay, you're okay, we're all okay, everybody's okay, and we just sweep everything under the carpet. It's kind of like Dan the Carpet Man. Dan the Carpet Man lays out the carpet, he gets the whole place set up around him, and he's looking out and he sees a little bump in the carpet. He's like, my cigarettes. I must have forgot my cigarettes. And so he looks for a rubber mallet, picks it up, and starts pounding out, you know, the little bump in the rug. He's like, that's better. We're all good. Packs up his stuff, heads out to his car. He goes to sit in his truck, and he looks, and there's his cigarettes sitting up there on the dash. And the lady of the house comes running out and says, Dan, hey, did you see my canary? He got out. There's always a villain, but we must need an avenger, and that's what Easter's about. Let's talk about the third one, and that's the avenged. It's the avenged. There has to be a reason for the avenger to come. There has to be a reason. There's a reason why Jesus came. He came to avenge our sins. God looked, there was no one, so he sends his right arm, Jesus. But remember, it's still not automatic that Jesus can be our avenger, because we still have free will. We still have a choice. And here's one way to look at it. You have Adam and Eve in the garden, and I want you guys to think about this. It started with a tree right in the middle of the garden, and if you eat of that tree, you will surely die. You'll go from spiritual life to spiritual death. But God gave them free will, and they went from spiritual life to spiritual death. And here's what God has done today. He's put a tree in your own life, and that tree is the cross of Christ. There's a new tree. The Bible says that cursed is he who hangs on a tree. And that tree's been put into your life, but not to go from spiritual life to spiritual death, but to take you from spiritual death to spiritual life. Amen. So now you can have life, and it's all because of a decision based on a tree. The first tree was the tree in the garden. The second tree was that Jesus hung on, was that cross. And it brings us life. We don't go from death to death. We go from death to life if we choose through our free will. Let's take a look in Luke 18, in verse 7 and 8. And shall God not avenge his own elect, that's his people, who cry out day and night to him? Though he bears long with them, I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. He will avenge them, every superhero. See, he avenged us. First of all, I want you to understand something. He avenged us for our behavior, our sins, the things that we would do wrong in our life. And he laid down, Jesus did, his life for you and I. Every superhero has an origin. And did you know every king of the ancient world were known as heroes? Every king was known as a hero. And to the ones that they saved, to the ones that they freed, they were heroes.
No other king could vanquish the war horse or silence the warrior's rage while riding the lowly back of a donkey. No other king could break the dominion of darkness, the tyranny of evil, with a reign of grace and a kingdom of peace. No other king could give his life for the redemption of rebels, his wealth to welcome the outcast. Jesus is that king, the king of glory, son of the living God. Not just another king, not just another prophet, not just another teacher. He was the one the world had been waiting for, the one to deliver us from captivity, the son of David and Abraham's chosen seed. He is the goal of the Mosaic law, Yahweh in the flesh. He is the one to establish God's reign and rule, to heal the sick, give sight to the blind, freedom to the prisoners, and proclaim good news to the poor. This Jesus was the creator come to earth and the beginning of a new creation. He embodied the covenant, fulfilled the commandments, and reversed the curse. This Jesus is the Christ that God spoke of to the serpent, the one prefigured to Noah in the flood, the one promised to Abraham, the one guaranteed to Moses before he died, the one promised to David during his reign, the one revealed to Isaiah as a suffering servant, the one predicted through the prophets and prepared for through John the Baptist. The Father's Son, Savior of the world, and substitute for our sins, more loving, more holy, and more wonderfully terrifying than we ever thought possible. He is our Jesus, and there is no other king like him. He is our God, our glory, our victorious Savior. There is no other king like him. There is no other king.
Last week, just a couple weeks ago, Kevin Lehman, I talked to you guys about him. Him and his wife, Kelly, they helped us in the first 5 months of launching Elevate Church. And you know, the interesting thing is he passed away at only 60 years of age. It was unexpected, it was sudden, and he passed away of a heart attack. He was an incredible man of compassion, an incredible man of empathy. He was a beloved husband, an adoring father, loving granddad. But most of all, he was a man of God who loved Jesus, who took his free will and decided to invite Jesus into his life, to help him through every frailty, every weakness, so that he could recover back to that place. So he chose to take Jesus as his Avenger. And I think we would be amiss to not stop and think about how fast life can change. We can focus so much on the future, we forget about the present. We can dwell so much on the past that we forget about the present, today, and here. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you, God, today. I thank you, God, for what you want to do in our lives. What better day than Easter Sunday to make a drastic change in our lives? And while we're praying, if you're here today and you're sitting there going, I don't know where my relationship is with Jesus, but I definitely understand on how he must have been the Avenger, because there was a villain and I need to be avenged. And today, Jesus wants to do that. He died on the cross. God sent him so that you could change your life. And all you had to do is choose right from the right tree. And it was the tree of the cross. And if that's you today, God wants to change your life. And all it takes is just a moment and a prayer where you say, Jesus, forgive me. Thank you for dying for my sins, my behavior. That was my choice, but you came to avenge my sins for me. And all I have to do is accept you. And so, Lord, I thank you. And I choose to follow you now. You know, maybe you're here and you're following the Lord. But my question is, understand, why did he come? He came to seek and save the lost. That was his mission. That was his plan, because he had to avenge the sins of all mankind. And if you're here today, understanding that he died for his church, what he wants you to do is to take that good news, it's called the gospel, and to begin to share it in richly with another person. He wants that story of Josh Whedon, who was a good Samaritan. No, there was none existed. And his church's job is to be that good Samaritan. The church's job is to go and to share his word, to find the lives and the people that need you, and to jump into there and do it and be a part of his church. That's what his church is all about, to be a part of that community. And if that's you today, I'm going to say a prayer for both. And God will speak into your life. He will walk in your life. He will strengthen your life. And all you have to do is just say yes. And so, Father, I thank you. God, today, forgive me. Forgive me for everything that I have done that I know was wrong. Or maybe I didn't know was wrong, but now I get it. Jesus, forgive me. And I dedicate the days of my life to now following after you. And Father, I thank you, God, today, that even as a follower of Jesus, as a follower of you, Lord, I say, Master, show me. God, I pray that you would set up divine appointments with people whose lives I can change. God, that you would strengthen me to do the work of the ministry, to be able to step up so that I can do what you've called me to do in my purpose. Lord, we thank you. Thank you for Easter. Thank you for dying for us. And thank you for what our future holds. In Jesus' name, amen.